So, if someone goes into a black hole, do they literally go to hell? Hell if I know. Hi, I'm Mike Siegel. I'm an astrophysicist. I write for Ordinary Times, and this is The Throughput. So, you may have seen this picture in the news. It is a remarkable picture taken by the Event Horizon Telescope of the black hole that is at the center of our Milky Way galaxy. We have suspected there was a black hole there for a while. About 100 years ago, when Karl Jansky invented radio astronomy, he turned his radio telescopes on and discovered a noise coming from the galactic center in the direction of Sagittarius. Over the decades, we came to theorize that that radio noise was emitted by an accretion disk around a black hole. That is, you have a black hole, you have this disk of material swirling into the black hole, and while the black hole itself does not give off light, that disk gives off light. And that was what he was detecting. A few years ago, a group of astrophysicists won the Nobel Prize for Physics for measuring the motions of stars in the center of the galaxy and showing that they were orbiting a mass that did not give off any light, but weighed about 4 million times the mass of the sun. The Event Horizon Telescope, which is a collaboration of radio telescopes all over the Earth, when they combine their signals, they can resolve detail as though they were a telescope the size of the Earth. They turned towards the galactic center and were able to get this remarkable image of the black hole. The shadow you see in the center is the black hole, and that orange disk around it, that's the accretion disk. And those lumps are material within the disk orbiting around and gradually falling into the black hole. This is a stunning achievement. This thing is very small, only a few million miles across. It's 26,000 light years away. So to get this resolution, they had to resolve as though you were reading the stitching on a baseball on the surface of the moon. This is only the second picture we've gotten of a black hole. And it's amazing, and I can't get over just how incredible this picture looks. To celebrate that, I'm going to start what I hope will be a series of videos that look at the depiction of black holes in movies and on TV and talk about what they get right and what they get wrong. Black holes are an endlessly fascinating subject. I have talked about black holes from everyone from age 8 to 80. And they are always interested in it. The one thing people always want to talk about is black holes. They are these incredible things that were theorized by Einstein, that were speculated about for 50 years, that many scientists think could not possibly exist. And now it's an area of aggressive research where we study black holes every day and we learn more and more about them and we confirm more and more pieces of the theory of general relativity. So they are a wonderful thing. And I want to look at the depiction of them in movies to see how often Hollywood gets it right and how often they get it wrong. Now, today's movie is going to be a rather interesting one. It was described by no less than Neil deGrasse Tyson as the most scientifically inaccurate movie ever made. And that is Disney's 1979 film, The Black Hole. The plot of The Black Hole goeth thusly. The spaceship Palomino is doing an exploration mission when it comes across a large black hole with the derelict of the ship, exploration ship Cygnus, orbiting around it. After landing on the ship, they discover that the crew is gone and the ship is run by robots controlled by Dr. Hans Reinhard, who has been studying the black hole, who has created an anti-gravity field that both keeps the Cygnus in orbit around the black hole and he hopes will allow it to go into the black hole and see what's inside the black hole. They eventually find out that the crew actually were murdered and lobotomized and turned into robots by Dr. Reinhard. They try to escape, but eventually a whole bunch of fighting goes on. The ship is damaged. Everyone falls into the black hole. Dr. Reinhard is trapped within the black hole while the Palomino crew escape and go through the black hole to something beyond. I saw this movie as a kid. It kind of freaked me out. I'll talk about the ending and how kind of crazy that was. It's a very interesting movie to come out of Disney since it's not really a kid's movie. It's a lot more creepy and intense than they usually did. But let's just dive in and see what's going on here.
The most destructive force in the universe, Harry. Nothing can escape it, not even light.
I had a professor who predicted that eventually black holes would devour the entire universe.
Why not? When you can see giant suns sucked in and disappear without a trace.
What they're talking about here is kind of accurate. Black holes are extreme objects. They are where the object has become so compact that light itself cannot escape. The more compact an object is, the higher the velocity a rocket or anything else would need to escape from the surface. As you squeeze it down, the escape velocity from the surface increases, and it eventually gets to the point where it's the speed of light, and that is a black hole. Most of the black holes we know are the result of supernovae leaving behind stellar remnants. Others are in the cores of galaxies that are a result of black holes merging over the many billions of years that the universe has been around and building up these monsters that weigh millions or billions of times the mass of the sun. Black holes exist. They can gobble up stars. They can have entire star systems just go in and be gobbled up by the black hole that will gradually swirl in. We've seen distant black holes light up like Christmas trees when material falls into them, sometimes entire stars. And so that is accurate. And this prediction that black holes would consume the entire universe, depending on what the fate of the universe is, we don't know the fate of the universe. Dark energy sort of threw us for a loop. I'll talk about that in another video. If the universe doesn't collapse or expand so fast it rips itself apart, you would eventually have black holes consume all the gas and dust in the universe, and the Milky Way would consist almost entirely of black holes. So far, so good. The one thing that's inaccurate here, and I'm going to just say it right now because you're going to see it fairly often, is the depiction of the black hole. Black holes, you have the black hole in the center, and then you have this disk of material swirling into it. That part is correct. But the way they depict it throughout the movie is wrong. They show it almost like a drain in a tub, that the black hole is at the bottom and the material sort of swirling down into it, like material going through a maelstrom. That's not accurate. That is a good 2D representation that we use in class or in illustrations to talk about how black holes work, how they distort the shape of space-time, but it's not actually how they look. What you would actually see is a black sphere and then a flat disk around it. And you might see distortions in that disk from gravitational lensing, from the gravity bending the light of the disk around it. The movie Interstellar has a much more accurate depiction of this. So throughout the movie, they continually display the black hole as though it were like a tunnel, as though it's like the drain in a tub that you would go into it, the material sinks into it, swirls into it. It's not that way. It's a three-dimensional thing. It has a sphere, and then it has a disk, and that material sort of falls inward into it, not down into it. It's a subtlety, but I think a really important way in which this movie portrays the black hole wrong.
Zero gravity.
Cut the power. Smooth as glass.
What happened?
Natural phenomena. Or something from that ship.
So the idea here is that as they get close to the black hole, they're being buffeted by the black hole's gravity. And then when they get close to the Cygnus, that buffeting stops and they're in free fall in zero gravity. This really doesn't make a lot of sense. First of all, the gravity around a black hole is not turbulent. It's pretty constant dragging you in. So going through that gravity is going to be no different than going around a planet or anything else like that. Gravity is gravity. It doesn't matter if it's from a black hole or from a sun. And so you wouldn't get this buffeting unless your engines are really unstable and shaking you around a lot. When they get near the Cygnus, that gravity disappears. And we'll eventually get an explanation for this, but the Cygnus is able to stay around the black hole by having this null gravity field around here that cancels out the gravity of the black hole. There's a plot reason for this, but it really doesn't make a lot of sense. Gravity is gravity. You can orbit stably around a black hole. We see things orbiting stably around a black hole. We see accretion disks around a black hole, and they're not all falling in or you having to use anti-gravity. They can stay there for months, years in that stable orbit until the friction brings them in closer to the black hole. One of the reasons we detect black holes is we can see stars orbiting around black holes. And it's probable that in somewhere out there, there are planets orbiting around black holes. We've discovered planets orbiting around pulsars, which are also created by supernovae. So it's quite possible that a planet could survive around a black hole and be in orbit around it. It's fine. One of the questions that astronomy professors like to ask students sometimes is, what would happen if the sun stayed the same mass but became a black hole? And we will tell them the answer in class. Nothing would happen to the Earth. I mean, it'd go dark, obviously, but gravity is gravity. Newton's law of gravity says that the gravitational force depends on the mass of the object and how far away it is. If you shrunk the sun down to a black hole, the mass hasn't changed. The distance to the center of the sun has not changed. So the effect of that gravity on you would not change. the Earth would continue to orbit around the sun just as it always did. But people miss this question on exams because the cultural perception that black holes are these giant vacuums that suck everything in is so strong that people just think, oh no, you would go spiraling into the black hole. That's not the case. You can establish a stable orbit around a black hole. There's no need for the Cygnus to create this null gravity field to cancel out the black hole and just sort of sit there stably outside the black hole. And maybe if you want to show off your technology, fine. But you could actually just go into orbit around the black hole. It's fine. You don't need whatever technology to do this. You don't even need engines. As long as you keep your orbit and as long as the black hole isn't increasing in mass, you're fine. I talked in my 2001 video about how orbits work. That you basically, you're always falling towards whatever is exerting gravity on you, but you're moving sideways so that by the time you fall, you've gone all the way around. It works with the Earth, it works with the Sun, it works with black holes. If they just put the Cygnus into an orbit, they can turn the engines off and just sit there stably for thousands of years if they need to. As the black hole accretes material and it increases in mass, that will gradually pull them in, but that's going to be a very slow process. You don't really need this whatever technology.
Charlie, what the hell are you made of? What if it were one of us out there?
Vincent is one of us.
So this thing goes on for a while with the Palominos tumbling towards the black hole and then turning on its engines and reversing. I'll just point out that the dynamics of this scene are just all over the place. First of all, they worry about Vincent falling, the robot falling into the black hole while they're tumbling. That's not going to happen. The spaceship is just falling into the black hole. Things fall at the same rates. So if Vincent isn't attached to the ship, he's just going to fall at the same rate. Remember Galileo with the balls in the tower dropping him and showing that they fall at the same rate, or showing on the moon that a feather and a hammer fall at the same rate. Gravity is going to pull him in as long as the Palomino's engines are off at the same rate that it's pulling in the spaceship. So that doesn't have to worry about. The crew also, sometimes they're floating around, sometimes they're sitting down. That's going to really depend on what the ship's doing. As it's falling into the black hole, they should be in free fall. They should be floating. You remember in my 2001 video, I talked about why people float in space, and it's because you're falling. There's no force resisting you. That's what creates that sensation of weight. There's no force resisting and pushing back against gravity. If you're free falling, gravity's just pulling you, and you're in free fall, like you're floating. Whereas if you're sitting on the floor or something like that, that floor is exerting a force pushing against gravity. That's what creates that sensation of weight. When the Palomino's engines turn on, they're still in free fall and floating around. And they shouldn't be doing that because now you have a force. You have the engines pushing back against gravity, pushing them away from the black hole. That should push them down into their seats. They should feel the sensation of weight. Just like when our astronauts go into space, when the ship launches and those engines are on, they're crushed down into their seats because of the tremendous G-forces. So that should be happening here. And sometimes they do it right, sometimes they do it wrong. They're just sort of all over the place depending on what they need for the plot. And it's really kind of aggravating to watch this.
All right, let's hurry. Okay.
Now, ironically, in this scene, they actually get it right. The Palomino is coming in to land on the Cygnus and fires her engines up, and they all settle down into their seats because now they're feeling a force that's resisting gravity, that's pushing them up. But it's still wrong because they don't need to fire their engines. I've talked about in videos before how you use engines to land when you're landing on planets or moons, things that exert gravity. If you're landing on a spaceship, it's not exerting gravity. So you don't need to use your engines to slow down and come in for a gentle landing. We've been docking spaceships with space stations for almost 50 years. Skylab predates this movie. When we dock a space capsule with a space station. We don't have engines blaring. They come in, they match orbits. They come in very gently. They use maneuvering jets to slowly move up and match because that motion can't be stopped. And so if you're going too fast, you're going to hit really hard and do some damage. So you don't need to land like this. They could just sort of nose up and dock really nicely with the Cygnus and it'd be fine.
If the data on my returning probe ship matches my computerized calculations, I will travel where no man has dared to go. Into the black hole. In. Through. And beyond. How do you expect the Cygnus to escape being crushed by the force in there?
I would assume that Dr. Reinhardt has created an anti-gravitational force field capable of withstanding that stress.
Indeed, and I know you will say, Captain, that one mistake in navigation can be fatal. But I know exactly what I'm doing. The course I have chosen will take the Cygnus through at its optimum angle of rotation. The vortex will cause us to move at incredible speed, and that angle will slingshot us through.
All right, so a lot of stuff here. First of all, we find out finally what the anti-gravitational device is. As you get close to a black hole, let's say you're falling feet first into a black hole, the force that is on your feet will be way stronger than the force of gravity that is on your head. And this will start to stretch you out into a process we call, give the very scientific name of spaghettification. It will stretch you out like a piece of spaghetti and eventually rip you apart. This is how black holes devour things. If stars or other things get close, they literally get ripped to shreds by the tidal forces of the black hole. And so if you try to send a spaceship into a black hole, depending on the size of the black hole and rotation and all that stuff, you would get ripped apart. So what he's done is create this field that cancels gravity so that doesn't happen. Even if you could generate anti-gravity, that's not enough. The forces inside the black hole are so strong that you'd need just tremendous differentials to be able to account for that. And you also have distortion of space-time itself, which is very difficult to deal with. And this idea that we're going to go through the vortex and it's going to slingshot it in us, that's not how black holes work. Again, they're thinking about a black hole as being like a maelstrom in the ocean or water draining out of a tub, and that you'll go with the rotation and that will sling you through. No, 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 no. It's a three-dimensional thing. A black hole is a sphere. When you go in, you go straight in. You don't go down like you're going down a drain. You go straight in. It's very hard for human beings to visualize this three-dimensionally or really four-dimensionally because we didn't evolve for that. But this is just an inaccurate representation of how black holes work and how you would send something into a black hole.
I also want you to monitor my flight. Stay as long as you can at the event horizon. There might be an Einstein-Rosen bridge to consider.
I will.
So Einstein-Rosen bridge, this is better known as a wormhole. A wormhole is a theoretical solution to Einstein's equations that would allow you to travel vast areas of space in an instant, essentially creating an extra-dimensional bridge that links two areas of space that are far apart in three-dimensional space, but by folding space, you bring them close together. This is used in Interstellar. It's used in A Wrinkle in Time. I've mentioned it before. The version of that an Einstein-Rosen bridge would be was where you would have a pair of objects, a black hole and a white hole. One of the solutions to Einstein's equations is for a black hole. Another one is for a white hole. This would be an object that emits things and to which nothing can go in. We have never detected a white hole. We don't know that they exist. They're just a theoretical construct. But the idea of an Einstein-Rosen bridge is that you would go into a black hole and come out of the white hole. Now, 40 years after this movie was made, this part of this theory is still very contested. There are some solutions that say white holes could exist, but only if they were in a different universe. Others require a theory of gravity that would require that instead of reaching infinite force and infinite density inside the black hole, you reach a maximum force and density, and then you would be able to have information. I don't know about spaceships, but at least information and particles go through the black hole and emerge from the white hole. The problem here is that the only way to tell which of these theories would be right, how gravity works inside a black hole, whether there's such thing as Einstein-Rosen bridge, whether there are white holes, would be to go into a black hole. And so if you are crushed to infinite density and destroyed, then you know your theory was wrong. If you go through the Einstein-Rosen bridge and emerge from the other side, then you know your theory was right. That's an extreme way to test your theory. The problem here is that Reinhardt wants the crew to measure his progress and see if his theories are confirmed. But you can't do that. Once you go through the event horizon, by definition, information cannot get out. That is the definition of a black hole. And so once he goes in, he won't be able to send any information back that can be reported to people outside. Just so they would say, oh, Reinhardt was right, or oh, he was wrong. And if the theories about wormholes are true, he'll exit into a different universe. And that trip can only go one way, from the black hole to the white hole. You can't reverse it and go backwards. And so he will know what happened, but the crew won't. Once you go into the black hole, once you go past the event horizon, that information is lost. As far as anyone else is concerned, you are destroyed. And whether you pass through the black hole or are crushed or destroyed, no way to know. So what causes Reinhardt's plan to go awry is that a meteor storm occurs and damages the ship and breaks it up, and it can't go into the black hole. Or it does, but as a wreck rather than as a consistent ship. Meteor storms are a thing that happens on Earth. When the Earth passes through the tail of a comet, we'll get lots of small little pieces of debris that enter our atmosphere, and that creates a meteor storm. If you're in space, those aren't meteors. Meteors refers to things hitting our atmosphere. If you're in space, that's an asteroid storm. It's a piece of nomenclature that movies mix up all the time. It kind of is annoying. The problem is, they don't just pop up all of a sudden. And they aren't red fireballs. Most of them are tiny. They're grains of sand or little rocks. They're not these big things that are going to destroy a ship. Rather conveniently hitting the ship and not hitting anything else. And the thing about the meteor shower is it's completely unnecessary. You have, right there, the most powerful force in the universe. A literal black hole. As you get closer to the black hole, the force it is exerting on one side of the spaceship is going to be way stronger than the force it's exerting on the other spaceship. If Reinhardt's field is off even just a little bit, it will rip the ship to pieces. It will spaghettify it. And so this is completely unnecessary. You don't need a meteor shower when you have a black hole right there. In the title of the movie, even. I don't understand this silliness. Why is this meteor rolling through the ship like the boulder from Indiana Jones? Meteors are going very fast. They should just punch through the ship like paper and leave a giant hole. There's no need for it to like roll down here and create this artificial tension. And why does it look like a red blood cell or something like that? It's kind of semi-transparent and red and all this stuff. It's just ridiculous. Also, there's a lot of hull breaches going on here, and no one is asphyxiating. They do have one scene where the hull breaches and the air is being sucked out, and all this ice shows up. They just do it in that one scene, and then everywhere else it seems to be fine, so very inconsistent in that, and so forth. So very strange how it does this.
Gravity force field is on. Control's not responding.
Captain, the ship has been programmed.
You mean we're going into the black hole? Yep.
Let's pray he was a genius.
So lots of problems here, and mainly having to do with thinking of the black hole as a two-dimensional thing rather than a three-dimensional thing. Again, it's not like water swirling out of a bathtub. You don't go up and down into it like you're going into the maelstrom. It is a three-dimensional thing. You have a black sphere with an accretion disk around it, and you would go straight in to the black hole. And if there's a white hole on the other end, you come straight out of it. Also, you wouldn't be like going down a tunnel. It would just be going into this thing and then coming out of this thing. So there's no tunnel to go into. It's just this disk underneath you and then darkness. Because that's another thing. If the interior of the black hole, assuming you survive the transition of the event horizon, would be black. That's why they're called black holes. Inside the black hole, The escape velocity is too high for light to escape. Light is not going to come out and reach you to hit your eyes so that you can see things around you. It should be just darkness inside the black hole, and then eventually light if you emerge from the other side. So this is just a complete misrepresentation of what it would be like to go into a black hole, and actually makes the movie less interesting in my view. How is he alive in space? There's no air. So this is the part of the movie that Neil deGrasse Tyson often goes on about, that there isn't a planet inside a black hole, there's no place where you'd have fire and people and all that stuff, and so on. My understanding of the end of the movie is a little different from his. I understand that this be to be more of a spiritual slash religious thing, where Reinhardt is fused into the body of Maximilian the robot, and can literally in hell. This is a literal representation of hell inside the black hole. And the crew of the Palomino, because they are not evil like Dr. Reinhardt, are saved and literally led out of the black hole by an angel to escape through the white hole. We don't know what's inside a black hole. If you want to make it heaven and hell, I guess you can. It's a little jarring because this kind of religious iconography is not hinted at anywhere else in the movie. And so it's a bit odd. But sure, you can have that. So overall, what do I think? Well, as a movie, I actually don't hate it. It's not as bad as I remember. The set design and the directing are really good. It has an all-star cast who do the best they can with the material. It has a really strong creepiness factor and some very disturbing imagery. The image of Dr. Reinhardt trapped inside the body of Maximilian was one that still haunts me to this day. And it features one of the all-time great scores by John Barry. I would rate this as one of my favorite all-time movie scores. On the other hand, the plot and the dialogue are kind of a bit clunky. There's a lot of needless exposition. For a 90-minute movie, it moves a little bit slowly at times. and its attempts to cash in on Star Wars aren't entirely successful, causing some jarring shifts in tone where you go from this sort of haunted house movie to this sort of shoot 'em up at the end and then to a religious movie at the end and so forth. I mean, I wouldn't call it great, but it's certainly watchable, and I would recommend checking it out sometime if you have Disney Plus. As for the science, well, black holes exist. Material does swirl into them. White holes are a theory, and Einstein-Rosen bridges could exist. But other than that, it's really, really bad. Almost as bad as Neil deGrasse Tyson says. Its depiction of how things work in space, of orbits, of this unnecessary null gravity field, needless to say, the ending of what it's like to go into a black hole, and its representation of a black hole as a two-dimensional thing rather than a three-dimensional thing, this is all way off. I don't know if the most scientifically inaccurate movie of all time is one I would affix to it, but I would certainly give it like a D at best. The kind of enraging thing is all of this could have been fixed. You could have had just the Cygnus in orbit rather than having that anti-gravitational field. You could have had the plan to send the probe in to begin with rather than sending the entire ship. You didn't need the asteroid storm, which was the dumbest part of the movie in my opinion. You could have just had the tidal forces of the black hole tearing the ship apart. And you could still incorporate the religious stuff if you want and the white hole and all that. That's fine. To me, the biggest sin is portraying the black hole as this two-dimensional maelstrom water swirling into the bathtub thing and not this three-dimensional sphere where everything sort of crushed inward. But on the other hand, if you made that movie, if you made it so that the orbits were right, if you made it so that the black hole was depicted accurately, if you made it so that the effects of time dilation, which I haven't talked about, was correct around that, if you had the interior of the way it should be portrayed, then we would have that movie that you would call Interstellar. And hopefully I will talk about that in a future episode of Dr. Mike Talks About Black Holes. And if you do want to see me talk about black holes again, be sure to hit that subscribe button. That's the best way to see these videos the second they come out. That was a fun romp. I do kind of recommend this movie. If you kind of turn your brain off, it does have its enjoyable aspects to it. But hopefully I'll be back in another couple weeks with another movie. In the meantime, I'm Mike Siegel. I'm an astrophysicist. I write for Ordinary Times, enjoy movies, enjoy science in movies, and thank you for watching.